Father, commit to you our time together. On a matter that's most crucial for discipleship, we pray that you would teach us what the heart of discipleship is, what the very heart of mentoring is all about. At the very heart of mentoring is the fruit of the Holy Spirit. At the very heart of the fruit of the Holy Spirit is the matter of kindness, the kindness of God, course through your people. And so, would you clarify what this means so that you might cause us to be found faithful? In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like for you to turn to Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 to 23. And let me warn you, this is going to be a very difficult topic, especially if you hail from the Philippines. Let's go. Galatians 5, 19 to 23. There's a recent survey on which country constitutes the most nice people. And no one even comes close. It's beyond compare. Pilipinas. Numero uno. No one comes close. The nation of the most nice people on planet Earth, bar none. Woo! It's more fun in the Philippines because of nice people around. By the way, that's an acronym for NPA, just in case you don't know. Well, true as it is in the social media, stay with me because chances are you will be shocked on what the Bible says about being nice. This is not to provide an affront to social media observation, not at all. There's nothing really wrong about what they're saying. As a matter of fact, we see that as a compliment. But if we're going to talk biblically, then there's another thing to be said. A social scientist recently made what I thought was a perceptive remark, comparing two assets, perceived assets. One, being nice and being kind. So as far as this scholar is concerned, nice or niceness or being nice is diametrically opposed to being kind. How's that? So he argues that niceness tolerates people. It's the tolerance of people. You tolerate them, and so you're nice. He said, on the other hand, kindness cares for people. The reason why he said that, he's providing a PowerPoint study that nations that are nice will be challenged on several aspects. If there is a nation whose people are not really nice, I'm talking about one nation in particular, no offense if there is one here from that nation, the Singaporeans are not a nice people. But they have the world's number one airport in terms of service, cleanliness, and ethics. Singapore. They're not nice, but they're kind. I do have a friend, pastor of one of the biggest churches, Tony Yao. I wish to invite him one of these days so that you'll see what I'm trying to bring up here. He's not nice, but he's kind. What's being said here is there a possibility that the reason why my country of origin is challenged with a lot of graft and corruption, is challenged with integrity issues, is because there's just too many nice people who just tolerate you. They don't like you, but they tolerate you. And when you turn your back, they kill you. They sell you in the marketplace. But whenever you're there, they're nice to you. So you'll never know who is with you and who is against you, because everyone in the Philippines is nice. But not in Singapore. In Singapore, they tell you who you are. If you have a booger, they'll tell you right off. Remove that booger. It's dangling. Oh, don't laugh. Someone said that to me. Not because he wants to insult me, but he wants for me to look good and not have some dangling modifier in my face. And so here, it's very important for us at the get-go to start with that kind of a graphic illustration that there seems to be a problem here. I'm not talking about being nice here, we're talking about biblical kindness. And when you're talking about biblical kindness, now that is a different word. Now I'd like to submit to you, the primary thesis of this sermon today is about this. It is our intention here at the Biblical Community Church to dream and hope for the day that every person here is actually being mentored by someone that he considers more mature, spiritually mature, and all of the above. And so, because you are being mentored, you are in the middle, you are actually mentoring another younger person. And so you're constantly in a midlife arrangement. You're in the middle. Someone's mentoring you, and you are mentoring another person. You are in the middle of a very, listen, kind relationship. And so if we're going to define what kindness is, we have to be clear. And that's the reason why our sermon today is entitled Clear Kindness, because we'd like to present to you that the primary ethic of discipleship at the Biblical Community Church is not niceness. You won't have a discipler who will tolerate you. That's not going to happen here, we pray. What's going to happen here is that you will have an arrangement where you have a big brother or a big sister, and you will be one yourself to another guy, where clear biblical kindness will be propagated. That person sincerely, genuinely cares for you and will tell you what's wrong with you and what's right with you. Will lift you up when you need to be lifted up, but will tell you straight when you need to be corrected. Now that is kindness. By the way, where did we get that ethic? We will see where we got it. It's not a human invention. It's biblical. And so we turn to the book of Galatians, which is a straight shooter, by the way. This is a book that was written to people like you, Christians. So let that be said. But there was a dysfunction because they were misreading ethics. They were going back to things that were so common and popular in their day and age. So let's turn to Galatians 5, 19 to 23. And I'd like to begin with 19. First slide, please. And verse 1 has to do with malignancy, or another term for malignancy, cancer. You know what cancer is? Simple form, simple definition. It's a living entity inside your body, a little cell, or maybe cells. And they are determined by way of some unusual adherence to an outer goal. There's an outer goal because they're supposed to be symbiotic. They're supposed to be help causing to the others inside the human body by way of an altered code. Suddenly, they're eating and destroying their neighbors. Anything that's near them, what gets in their way, they kill them. That's a cancer cell. Now, since the body of Christ is a living organism, the church in Galatians had cancer cells. And the apostle, through the work of the Holy Spirit, is censuring this people who were adopting a false mode. And so this is why it's called cancer. This is how it looked like. He was rebuking them and he was telling them, you know, something wrong is happening here. The acts of the flesh, can't you see that they're obvious? You don't need to be some kind of a social scientist to be able to detect this. They are so obvious. Look, sexual immorality. Why are some of you engaged in here? Impurity, debauchery, public demonstration of lewdness. Some of you have gone back to idolatry and magic, witchcraft. Some of you, I can't believe it, Paul is saying, you're starting to be hateful. Some of you are into discord, which is basically dividing the ranks. Letting others know that you're right and the others are wrong in a very negative way. Building up camps and cliques. Jealousy. Fits of rage. Selfish ambition. What's happening to you? Dissension. Dividing the ranks. Don't you realize that the singular paramount prayer of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane was that the church, the body of Christ, might become united and one? If there's any one thing that Jesus buried his soul in the prayer, it is this, that the church would become one. And now you're resorting to divisiveness and you're causing dissensions. What happened? That's what the apostle is trying to tell them. Factions. You've separated your local church into groupings by way of preferences. Envy, drunkenness, orgy, and the like. I warned you, very strong. You cancer cells. And I'm doing this again, he said, because this is not the first time that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. That's not a mild term. What's being said here is there will be no tolerance for cancer cells in the kingdom of God. And so when I look at this, it is with a tinge of seriousness. We take this in our day and age, we kind of look at this list of it's not an exhaustive list, to be sure, but it is a short list of all of the above. And to a certain extent, there is not a Christian that I know in this day and age that will not be able to fall prey to this, because they seem to be so normal. Like, take for example the center point. The center point is the causing of division, the causing of factions. We live in North America, people, and in North America, your opinion matters. And so if you have an opinion, all you have to do is to have one leader in church to differ with your opinion, and that's enough to ignite a revolution. Just your opinion. And if there's a personal preference, like you want a carpet that's green instead of gray, you can actually quarter a group and rail a protest and say, we are the Green Party. We want everything green, including the carpet. I have seen people, churches like this, separate on the color of carpets. And the Apostle Paul is railing on this, not because he has an axe to grind, but he feels strongly that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is quenched whenever this laundry list is out present in the people of God. It's cancerous. Because it's cancerous, there is actually a different look. And the next slide, please. It's the opposite of cancer, which is the cruciform derived from the cross. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Jesus who lives through me. That is the slogan of every Christian who says that he surrendered his life to Jesus. He is to live a cruciform life. And if you want to see a PowerPoint, again, this is not an exhaustive list. This is what you're going to see in a person who is living the cruciform life, as it's good for our assessments. But then the exact opposite is this. Have you forgotten that this is supposed to be your life? The fruit of the Spirit. You're supposed to manifest this. Take note, this is singular. It doesn't mean that love, joy, peace are the scenes. No, don't extend that too far. This is just to say that these are the manifestations of a person who's saying that he knows God. Spirit-filled. Spirit-walking. You see this made manifest in a person 24/7. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. At the very center of that list, did you notice? At the very center is the word kind, because the kindness of God in Greek and in Hebrew is a very powerful word. The word Christotes, it means God is good. And we say all the time. Yeah, right? God is good. That's the Greek word Christotes, which means divine kindness out of which God acts towards men. It means the proactive goodness of God. The energetic, intentional goodness of God that never stops, without which we will all perish. And so, the energetic principle of Christotes here, kindness is this. Whatever it takes for you to become like Christ, I'm committed to that. People, that is kindness defined. So, is that a lame definition of just being nice? I don't think so. That's the reason why it is humanly impossible for God's people to be kind, biblically. You know why? Because I don't have that in me. I go by default to myself. And I don't care what you feel and what you think. So long as I spit out my preferences, that's what's important. That's not going to sync well with God. Because as far as God is concerned, I died to that already. And so how do I live? Cruciform life is to understand that we subscribe to the manual of life. And that manual is the Word of God. It is the Word of God. He is not suggesting principles, people. He is commanding life. Why? Because he knows redemption is what we need. Redemption. And redemption is radical. You have to subscribe 100% to scriptures in order for this to work. In order for that to work, cruciform is needed. And so, in the discipling relationships, if you're going to look at the vision of the biblical community church, it is this: transforming you, transforming God's people into generic followers of Jesus? No. Transforming people into biblically equipped. And that's very strong. Biblically equipped followers of Jesus Christ. Now I challenge you to look around and look for a church that's serious about that. And I propose and I submit to you that you will be surprised on how many evangelical churches these days are not subscribed to that. They are subscribed to that, into a certain extent, but not completely. And subscription to the Bible, not 100%, is not subscription to the Word of God at all. It's all or nothing for God's counsel, people. And the Biblical Community Church, and I hope all the churches who claim to be followers of Jesus, would do the same. And that puts you distinctively. That's why I feel the Biblical Community Church will never become popular. Why? Because what culture would it subscribe to a philosophy of life where it claims that God and His Word must have the final cultural word? It will have to be the work of God, or else it's not going to happen. But I'm glad you're here, because it's telling me something here, that you're willing to take God at His Word and live the cruciform life. That means, if you submit to discipleship, that means you allow one person to mentor you, and then you are going to mentor another person, you are actually allowing the kindness of God to be your primary ethic. And by kindness of God, this is what we mean. You're giving the license to this man or this woman who is mentoring you to tell you exactly what's good about what you're doing, to lift you up, to reinforce it. Well done, well done. Well done. Please continue doing that. It's encouraging me. And then, on the other breath, to give the other person the license to rebuke you and to correct you. I know in Filipino circles this is the most difficult thing to do, because we'd rather be nice. Not stir the water, not talk about it. Not talk about it and hope that he'll get it. Don't worry, he's a Christian, he'll get it somehow. No, he will not get it. No, she will not get it. You can't be nice. How many years have I languished with my exposure to nice people around me? Haven't checked me. Didn't correct me on my foibles. And the rare people, where there's only a few, a handful of people, who are so committed to me, would come up straight to me and say, "This is very difficult for me, brother, but I think you're wrong." And the reason why you're wrong is not because I think you're wrong. I think the Bible tells me that you're wrong. And then I look at that person and I say, the internal combustion immediately surfaces. Of course, immediately I would put up a defense mechanism. But there is no defense for a man sincerely concerned. You look at his eyes and his heart and you know that that person really cares for you. It's the work of the Holy Spirit when you allow a proper rebuke and a proper corrective from a man who loves Jesus. And he cares enough for you to tell you there's a booger in your heart. At the Biblical Community Church, people, we plan and we pray to raise encouragers like Barnabas. But we also plan and pray to raise prophets like Nathan, who will look at you in the eye and say, "You are sinning. Drop it and sin no more." That's a proper balance. Isn't that the proactive energy of God? Isn't that the act of kindness of God? We wait for God, and what does He say in Scripture? "Please do not misconstrue my delay as tardiness." God is saying that. It is my act of kindness. For this day and age, I'm making sure that you get it. I'm encouraging those who need to be encouraged. But I'm actually ushering an era of rebuke so that you will know the waywardness of your ways. So turn around and follow me. And go back to your first love. That is cruciform. How are we going to apply all these things? before we apply all these things, there is a man here who wishes to be cruciformed. You know what a cruciformed man is? A man who wants to be a pastor is a man who wants to be crucified. Huh? And so I'm presenting the Mount of Marks. We presented, we are presenting the four ordination candidates, and the third one is Captain Michael Lupina, a veteran of the U.S. Army, well loved, let me say that, and a very keen soldier who believed God called him out from the infantry of the United States Army and into the infantry of the Sandatahang Lakas ng Panginoong Jesus. You know how to translate that? The powerful force of Jesus Christ, the invisible kingdom force of Jesus Christ, and he is heeding the call. He needs all the help that he can get, because on April 21st, from 9 to 12, you are invited, by the way, to show up. Because the ordination test is about you getting encouraged that this man are the proper men called by God. The purpose of the ordination is the pastor, alongside with the elders and the deacons, would look at men whom are deemed fit for gospel ministry, and your pastor leading, I say, these are the men that we believe are called by God, and we are so proud of them. And we are presenting them to you now because they're going to be scrutinized in real good details. They will be asked questions that will make them bleed. On April 21, they will be here at 5 o'clock in the morning. Did you note that, Michael? That's a Saturday. You are not coming here at 5, okay? But they will be here at 5 for prayer. At 6 to 8 is the written exams on Bible knowledge. And then they will have a very nice breakfast from 8 to 9. At 9 a.m. sharp, they will be sat here in front of you, all four and their spouses. And there will be a board of examiners in front of them, seasoned veterans in prison work. Some of them dean of seminaries, some of them in Christian affiliates, some of them Christian businessmen, just a wide variety and array of panelists. And then you will make them nervous, because the panelists will be the primary questionnaires, but you will be allowed to ask questions too. Not verbally, but in written form. They will be collated. And in the interest of time, of course, not all your questions will be read, because if that happens, there will be an entire day of questioning here. We will just collate and make sure that the questions asked are representative of what's being asked. But at 9 to 12 will be the scrutiny, and it is my ardent prayer that we will satisfy your curiosity that these four young men are indeed called by God. I'm calling on Captain Michael Lupina to share his testimony. Please welcome him.
Hearing that, I'm a little nervous already. What's to come? Get situated here. Can you hear me? Is that good?
Amen.
So,
thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, Pastor Robert, the elders and the deacons of our church,
and you, to all of you, and especially to the parents who trust the youth ministry to allow us to be a good steward of your children. I've been a member of this church since 2010. My wonderful wife introduced me to this church. Happy birthday. It's a birthday party. I've been serving as your youth ministry director since 2013. So it's been quite a while, and it's been truly a blessing. And to be honest with you, I'm so humble. I don't deserve to be standing here. When I share my testimony, when I think about my past, I do not deserve to be here. But just by the grace of God that I'm here. I'm American born. You may notice that I speak. I do not have a mastery of the Tagalog language. But thankfully, the Lord has completed me with Rosalie. She's my translator. So if you talk to me in Tagalog and I'm looking at you with this blank stare, it's because I really don't know. But both of my parents are Ilocano, they're in the West region. My dad was in the U.S. Army as well. That's how he was naturalized and we became citizens. My mom is probably like 9% of y'all, was a nurse, and she's a labor and delivery nurse. I'm just guessing on the statistics. And we migrated to, well, I was born here in Texas. So this is, I am American Filipino. I do know a few words though, in Ilocano. Natoy. Tata. And wood. Right? Here? There. Yeah. That's it. Anything beyond that, I struggle. But I'm willing, but because I don't know, I'm willing to learn. So please bear with me. Please talk slow to me if you're talking to me in Tagalog or Ilocano. When I was young, my parents divorced. I grew up from a broken household when I was in sixth grade. So that desire to learn the language was gone. My parents broke apart. English became the only language in my household. It was tough because my mom was a night shift, single mom, night shift nurse, asleep throughout the day. My brother, my kuya, has Down syndrome, so I didn't have a close relationship with him. My ate, she was already out of the house. She's 7 years older than me. To put in perspective, I'm 34, so I'm a lot older than that, but this is back then. And so, in that loneliness, I wanted to pursue what I thought you can find family and friendships. Through friends, I would find family. And unfortunately, I hung out the wrong crowd. I hung out with the crowd that introduced me to drugs. That was my fulfillment. From middle school to high school, even into my university days, I pursued fulfillment in the wrong places, in the wrong source. For much of my life, I like to compare it to a piece of driftwood. Does anyone know what driftwood is? It's a useless branch that just floats in a river or in a body of water, going into places that are deep and dark, dirty. Going wherever the flow takes you. Hey, Mike, you want to be cool? Let's do this. Yeah. Let's do that. You want to be one of us? Just going with the flow. The lowest point in my life was when I started doing methamphetamines and cocaine with my uncle, my family. I'm being authentic with you. I'm getting deep with you. This is my testimony, if you're wondering why. That was a deep, dark point in my life. And one day, my uncle stopped. Like, there was this transformation in his life. Like, he was happier. He didn't pursue the things that could kill you or destroy you. I mean, it was different. Like, where did this transformation come from? And he shared with me, Mike, do you know who Jesus is? And I heard about Jesus, but I didn't know who Jesus was. Please tell me more. I wanted to know more. A demonstration of faith through his life is what saved me when I heard the gospel. Like, there's this craving that there's another way to live, knowing that there's another way to live. Man, that's amazing. And so on March of 2006, I mean, if you think about it, that's 12 years ago, I was saved and baptized. I like to look at the passage John 15, 5 through 6, when Jesus says, I am the vine and you are the branches. I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile and burned. I was that branch. That was me. Fast forward to 2010. Oof, I'm skipping. I came here to BCC. Now, when I was saved in 2006, there was stagnant growth. I attended with my auntie and uncle, African American Pentecostal Prosperity Based Church. Woo! If you ever been to their worship service, it's different. And their preaching, a lot different. And but I knew something was different, right? Because I knew I was saved. I knew I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. My grace I am saved by my faith. And yet, there's something different. And I left the church back then, 2006, and my life stagnant, became stagnant for quite a while. And when I was stationed in Fort Hood, I met Rosalie, and she's like, hey, let's come to BCC, I'm going to introduce y'all, I'm going to introduce you to my family, my church family. And this is where I came here. I just, Mike, my friend, right, so always the friend. I love the community that I never saw at my old church. As I continued to when I became a member and I got to know more, when I was able to serve at this church, I was able to see, like, wow, there's church outside of Sunday at BCC. If you think about it, Wednesday night prayer meeting, there's Bible study on Thursday or Friday. I joined Heights. With my wife, and we were singing and praising God on Saturday to prepare for Sunday. That's crazy. Biblical community, a demonstration of faith within a group of people, within a church. It's amazing. So I was drawn to BCC. I started to serve with the young ones. I remember the first task that I was given was VBS director, your mission. Right, Mike, is to organize a VBS, Amazing Wonder. I don't know if anyone remembers that, way back then. And I love it. It's so different. It's so different from the Army. People are, you know, you still have a whole bunch of kids running around, right? But, you know, but other than that, it's different. And so I loved serving here. And so, but I knew I wasn't equipped enough. I didn't have enough biblical training. I there's the scripture, but just like you, sometimes I'm like, oh man, the book of Numbers, how does that apply? Like stuff like that. I wanted to know more. There was this hunger to know more. And so I asked Pastor Butch, where did you get trained? Where did you get this equipping in? Dallas Theological Seminary. Wow, that was, I applied, in July 2012, I accepted in August. just the time span. And so I'm still going to Dallas Theological Seminary, and I've realized I cannot do the Master's in Theology in 3 years. Do the math. I've accepted the fact that it's going to take me, hopefully, Lord willing, I only need 11 more classes, y'all. So it's around the corner. And I know the struggles. I see my brother Josh, who goes to DTS, as well as Victoria. She's also a fellow seminarian. my brother, Zion, back there, recording me, and my wife as well. She's also a fellow classmate. I'd rather she to work there full-time, so I get a discount. There's that call to serve the ministry because I know that the Lord can take something, someone like me, broken, imperfect, messed up. And I do believe in signs, wonders, and miracles when I say that He can take someone like me and transform that person to be a new creature.
Amen.
A preacher. 12 years ago, I would not have pictured myself being humbled, standing here and share this testimony to you all. But I truly believe that I am called to serve. That's my desire, to preach God's word to the other driftwood, to the other branches, to those that desperately need God's word. So please pray for me, please pray for us, please pray for my wife, please pray for my family. It's so hard being in school with a family. It's so challenging. When you're a seminary student that's broke, you lose on hope. But thank you for listening to my testimony, and I hope this is a pretty cool application for you, Pastor.
I'm called Austin. Okay.
Rosalie, do you love him? If one can refer to Rosalie as Lucy Lou, just don't let this lips deceive you. They once played one-on-one basketball. Don't ask me who won. Rosalie's a varsity basketball player, just so you know. So she's got the handles. That's not a pun. Now, are you nervous for the ordination exam? No. Okay. Well, it's up.
People, let's pray for them. Our Father, we heard the story, the beautiful story of this young man, Michael, and the beautiful bride, Gay, and their baby, Evie. And it is our prayer, nothing more, nothing less. But may the Lord of the harvest, who calls His sentinels into the harvest, be the one to supply all that is best for this young man and his bride to soar on wings like eagles, to lead your people with kindness. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Be well. Be well, brother.
So for application, I have only two things. For application, the first one being, applying to Michael actually, the first application is this, especially youth, those of you who have young high schoolers, those who are under Michael. Michael is the director for youth ministry. Would you please pray for this? Would you please ask your children to give their mentors? And if you are a young person here, would you please give your mentors permission to warn you? Kindly. And I don't mean nice, okay? Because if they're nice to you, forget it. That's gonna happen to you. Give them permission. It's very interesting that you and I a lot of times presuppose that just because you are being discipled that you are going to be warned. No, that's not going to happen. I think it's imperative that you allow your mentors the permission to warn you at all cost. Of course, it's imperative that they encourage you to lift you up. But the tricky thing is when things need to be corrected, because more often than not, it is the little things like greed, lust, self-centeredness, divisiveness that are left unchecked. You know why? Because it's easy to rationalize those things. Like the reason why I am like this, and the reason why I hate him, the reason why this is this,
is because of this, and you rationalize it and you don't consider it as sin. People, I've been a pastor for a limited number of years, since 1988. Never has one person come up to me and say, "Pastor, let me make a confession." Never one person come up to me and say, now, but a lot of people, a lot of men come up to me and say, "Pastor, I'd like to make a confession. I'm unfaithful to my wife. Can you please pray for me? Because I'm ready to make a confession." I have lots of those. But never have I received a confession from a person who comes up to me and says, "Pastor, I'd like to make a confession because I'm a very divisive man. I'm causing division. That's my propensity. Just more so." I've never had that. You know, I'm a person who is prone to dividing the ranks. Never. You know why? Because we think we never do that. Never. Because we're always right. Our preferences are always right. Our orientation is the best. And others are always wrong. Not according to your mentor, if he's kind to you. Because if your mentor is biblically oriented, he will not even pay attention to his own orientation. He will look at the Bible and size it up and tell you straight, "You got a booger in your heart, brother." Would you give them the permission to warn you? You know what's going to happen? My goodness. There's going to be a flourishing like no other. I am praying that there's going to be a mighty, mighty kindness that's going to surface within our ranks. By the way, is this safe? It's in the Bible. It better be safe. You better trust. One of the fundamentals before we go to number two, the disconnect here is this. You are constantly asking, "Am I going to confess this thing to my brother? Does he really know that this is my struggle? Okay, I will. But I will package it this way with this very important term, the big C." We're talking about cancer here. But the big C is not really cancer. It is the handcuff that some of us are so used to bringing when you make confessions like this. "Brother David, you know, okay, I came to terms with myself, so I'm going to make a confession. Okay. I stole something from Edison. But it's just between the two of us, okay? So here's the handcuff. I told you already, okay? Just the two of us. Don't even tell Edison. Okay? Because you're my mentor." How silly is that? But do you know that these kinds of relationships exist here? And do you know why your elders are handcuffed and not able to do anything? Because of that silly arrangement. That you open your proposition like this. Sating dalawa ng ito, ha? My goodness. Do you ever find that in the Bible? When you go for discipleship, you should go by this decorum. My mentor is accountable to God. And so, I am assuming that he is not a gossip. If I go to David Tanagi to the sin like that, I'm expecting him not to sell me out in the marketplace. Because he should know. You know what he should tell me? At that point, he's going to tell me this. "Brother Butch, why are you telling me this? You didn't steal from me. You stole from Brother Edison. So, please, I'm not going to remember this conversation. Go back to Brother Edison and talk to him and return his wallet." That is the proper thing, not this. Really? Okay, it's just the two of us. My goodness. You stole from him? Nah, Brother David, it's just the two of us. Remember, confidential. Okay. When he grows up, he goes to his mother. "Mom, I can't bear this anymore.
I didn't realize that Pastor Rosie is a thief. And I didn't realize about Choke. Just about Choke, what do you think is going to be done? And so Adelinda calls the Philippines. They're having a prayer meeting. And while they're having a prayer meeting in Barangay Liblib, Adelinda goes and she says, you know, this is such a burden because he's a man of God. And he stole something. I don't even know his name. Before you know, there's an entire conflagration of Barangay Kutun. Who thinks that I am a man of Satan. When all that I did was to bring a handcuff to a guy who's supposed to be confidential anyway. You know what the disconnect in here is? When people do not understand how the Bible works, that's the reason why you have to pray for your mentor. That they would be more than anything else, men and women subscribe to scriptures more than anything else. But if you have a man like that mentoring you, people, you're going to be Superman. Spiritual Superman. And I'm praying that that's what's going to happen. That's what we're praying for. That's why the training grounds will happen quickly, soon, I hope. But please find those arrangements quickly, because you cannot live the Christian life without a mentor. Please drop the handcuffs, please. Please drop the handcuffs. Let God take care of the confidentiality. We know what we're doing. This is not a gossip market. If there is anything that is so repugnant in the eyes and the ears of God, it is slander and gossip, and it will not be tolerated in this congregation, because we go before God to stop it right there when it's happening. So, give your mentors permission to be kind, to warn you. The second thing, would you please give the Holy Spirit unlimited access to alter your behavior? If you're thinking like Michael, this is impossible. How can a man like me be changed by God? I have multiple dysfunctions, sins of all kinds. You think God's going to work this thing? I don't think so. Well, you better think so. Because if you allow the Holy Spirit all access to you, your behavior will change. And don't believe that orientation for a second that your DNA is Filipino, and so this will never work for you because you're Juan de la Cruz. No way. The only reason why the Biblical Community Church exists is because we frost the priority of Filipino culture in this church. We are primarily Christian Filipinos here. Most of you anyway. This is not a Filipino church. This is a Christian church. It just so happens that there are many Filipinos. Primarily, this is a Christian Filipino church, not a Filipino Christian church. The priority is Christianity. And I pray that is leveraged by walking in the Spirit, in the life of the Holy Spirit. Where? People, through biblical kindness is practiced genuinely. Would you pray with me to make this happen? Father God, we know this is impossible, but because you said so, then it's going to happen. We pray for Christotes. Your goodness, your kindness, your proactive energy to make all things work. In the name of Christ, be a reality in and through our lives. May we be so true in encouraging one another. May we be so faithful in correcting one another because of Christ's love. Let the kindness of Jesus be your portion. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.